go.
Yeah. Good evening, everybody. My name is Jeffrey West, and I'm on the faculty at the Santa Fe Institute. And it's my pleasure to introduce tonight's speaker. But before doing so, I want to acknowledge on the part of the Santa Fe Institute the very generous support of the MacKinnon Family Foundation, of the Santa Fe Reporter, and of course, the Lenzik Center for supporting this series. I think it's a tremendous addition to Santa Fe, and it's wonderful to see so many people taking advantage of it. So thank you very much. I've also been asked, give them applause, yes. I've also been asked to advertise next month's lecture. You know, we do this on a monthly basis, and that's on June the 20th, and it's by Andrea Wolf, who is actually associated with the Santa Fe Institute. She's on our so-called fractal faculty. She is a writer and has written a best-selling book, which some of you may have already read or at least seen. It's Magnificent Rebels, The First Romantics and the Invention of Self. So that's a very challenging title, and I can assure you it's a very stimulating and provocative talk, which I'm sure all of you will enjoy. So tonight's speaker is Professor John Baez. He's a professor of mathematics at the University of California at Riverside, where he's been for almost 30 years. He got his undergraduate degree in mathematics at MIT and his doctorate at Princeton, also in mathematics, and is sort of best known outside the mathematics community for his presence on the internet. He's he writes occasional, or maybe even weekly, articles, tweets, whatever, that are incredibly provocative, interesting, informative about ideas in science. And he's a wonderful pedagogue, and I'm sure that will come out in tonight's talk. The title of his talk, as I'm sure you've seen, is Visions for the Future of Physics. Now, I'm a physicist, and I'm sure many of you know that prediction is a central part of physics. Physics is a central part of science, but physics is maybe the sort of quintessential example of that. It's part of the whole process of scientific advancement, is making theories, making models, making predictions, which one tests with observation and experiment. And physics has been enormously successful in doing that. And we wouldn't be here without that. I mean, the whole technological universe that we live in comes from the precision of those predictions. On the other hand, physicists rarely make predictions outside of physics, I would say, about society, or particularly where physics is going. So this is very unusual. Although I noticed John tempered the title by saying visions rather than predictions. But it reminded me, and I'm just going to give a couple of quotes, of some quotes from physicists concerning the future of physics. And one of the more famous ones is by the famous physicist Niels Bohr, for whom we owe the beginnings of atomic physics, the idea of the atom. In which he said, prediction is very difficult, especially if it's about the future. Now, another quote I'd like to give you is from a man named Lord Kelvin. Some of you may have heard of him. Some people say he was the greatest physicist of the last part of the 20th century, so much so that he's in fact buried next to Isaac Newton in Westminster Abbey. And he's the man that invented the term thermodynamics and things like kinetic energy and potential energy. He's well known for many things. And he made this statement, which has become notorious in physics. At the end of the 19th century, he said, "There is nothing new to be discovered in physics now. All that remains is more and more precise measurement." And of course, very soon after came atomic physics, quantum mechanics, relativity, and a whole new way of thinking about the physical world. And he was also known for a kind of a quote that is worthy only of Donald Trump, namely, X-rays are a hoax, he said. Now, physicists, as I say, don't make many predictions about the future of the science, or even about the future, actually. But economists do, and they're notorious for getting it wrong almost all the time. And one of the most famous ones was John Maynard Keynes, who wrote an essay in 1930 looking into the next 100 years. And he predicted that in 100 years, so almost now, this was written in 1930, he predicted that the work hour would be 15 hours. We'd all be working 15 hours a week. And the great challenge for humanity was, what are we going to do with all our leisure time? So that's what his vision of the future was. And that was taken up 30-odd years later by a well-known physicist. This is a physicist talking about the future, Sir Charles Darwin. Now, that is the grandson of the Sir Charles Darwin, but this Sir Charles Darwin was a very well-known physicist too. And he said the following: take it that there are 50 hours a week of possible working time, the technologists, now of course Silicon Valley, working for 50 hours a week will be making inventions so the rest of the world need only work 25 hours a week. And he also said, what the hell are we going to do keeping people happy for the other time, or the leisure time? So there's been this sort of weird history of prediction. And I'm going to finish up with one last prediction from a physicist, which is absolutely correct, completely correct. And it's a prediction made by Stephen Hawking, the famous cosmologist, general relativist. And here's the question that he was asked at the turn of the millennium, 20-odd years ago. Some say that while the 20th century was the century of physics, we are now entering the century of biology. What do you think of this? To which he responded, I think the next century will be the century of complexity. Obviously correct. And indeed, that is, of course, he was referring to the Santa Fe Institute, because that's where the science of complexity was basically founded. And it is the place that is going to be the hub for the science of the 21st century. And with that, I should turn it over to John for, I'm sure, a very provocative and entertaining talk. Thank you.
Thanks very much for that introduction. Somewhat intimidating introduction, because he starts by explaining how many of these predictions are wrong. So I'm on my toes. I wanted you to give me an honest show of hands. I want to cover my eyes so I can see your hands. How many of you thought that this was going to be Joan Baez? Are you serious? Because it's quite possible. So I really apologize. She's my cousin. I'd prepared a short song, but I decided no. Okay, well, yeah. So I was walking by the theater earlier this week, and I saw the marquee, and it said my name on it. But I said, Joan Baez? Why? Is she still touring? But anyway, so I'd like to say some things. I thank the Santa Fe Institute very much for inviting me here to speak about some visions of the future of physics. And yes, I don't want to think of these as predictions, but just possibilities. And you have to set it in the right context, which is the 20th century, the last century, and that really was the century of fundamental physics. So it's a little hard to define fundamental physics, and I don't want to sink into it in too much detail, but it means something pretty specific, at least for a bunch of us. So fundamental sounds good, but it doesn't mean that every good kind of physics is fundamental physics. Fundamental physics, the dream of it would be something like you could find some equations that you could write on a postcard that would be the laws of physics, and then in principle, from those, you could calculate everything that you can calculate using laws of physics. So that in principle carries a lot of weight there, because, for example, we know enough physics to, in principle, calculate the melting point of water. We know the physics that governs water well enough to do that, but it's actually incredibly hard to do that. So in principle, bears a lot of weight there. But anyway, people going into physics in the 20th century were, I think, looking for some fundamental laws that govern the cosmos in that carefully delimited sense. And if you think about the history, you'll see what I mean. So in 1897, Thomson discovered electrons experimentally by making what we would now call maybe like a vacuum tube or a cathode ray tube. It found that you could shoot a beam of little particles, which turned out to be electrons. Then in 1905, Einstein showed that light is made of particles. Theoretically, he made calculations that showed that light is made of particles that we later called photons. And it was quite a while before people really believed that. It took a lot of experiments and getting used to the idea that light was made of particles. Now, 1905 was a special year because also in 1905, Einstein showed how to prove that matter is made of atoms. He showed that if you watch carefully how pollen wiggles around when it's in water, it's being buffeted by little atoms, and you can use the statistics of how it's wiggling around to figure out the size of atoms. And then shortly after that, someone did the experiment and basically calculated how many atoms there are, for example, in a cubic centimeter of water. It's sort of amazing to realize it, but in 1905, there were still a lot of good scientists, physicists, who didn't believe in atoms, but this sort of clinched it. Also in 1905, he had a very busy year, he unified space and time. He showed that space and time are two aspects of the same thing, and that means also that, for example, energy and momentum are two aspects of the same thing. E equals mc squared is a spin-off of that. All of this follows from the unity of space and time in his theory called special relativity. In 1911, Rutherford discovered that atoms contain a much smaller thing in the center of them called a nucleus. Most of the mass of an atom is in a tiny little particle in the middle. These orange guys here are experimental discoveries that were unexpected, that people hadn't really expected from any theory, whereas the green ones are theoretical predictions that were later borne out. In 1915, Einstein completed his work on space-time by showing that gravity is really just the bending of space and time. And so his theory of general relativity, which later on was used to predict things like black holes and the Big Bang, was found then. So this is an amazing change, if you think about it, in just, I guess, 18 years of our worldview. Our whole worldview is rapidly changing at that time. And then there was a lot of work trying to understand the nature of atoms after people got used to the idea of them, but I won't go through all that. In 1927, Schrödinger came up with Schrödinger's equation, which is a precise equation describing how all particles are also waves, and also vice versa, all waves are particles. And that's called quantum mechanics, and that has had a huge impact, basically, all our understanding of matter and chemistry is now owed to quantum mechanics. And it continues on from there and became more abstruse, I might say, after that, because in some sense, this is most of what you need to understand the world that we can see around us in this auditorium. But it continued on into deeper and deeper understanding of physics until roughly around 1980, which is, I think, around the time when the last theoretical predictions have been made, which were subsequently verified by experiment. So in other words, people have continued making predictions after 1980. You've heard of string theory, and there are lots of other kinds of theories, but none of those theories of fundamental physics made any predictions after 1980 that have been verified since then. And there are only a few of these orange experimental breakthroughs in fundamental physics since 1980. The two that I keep in mind the most are the discovery that neutrinos can turn into other kinds of neutrinos, and also the discovery that the expansion of the universe is accelerating, it's speeding up. That's often called the theory of dark energy. We don't really know what dark energy is, but that would be the simplest explanation of why the universe is expanding faster and faster. But the main thing is that that was an unexpected discovery that was just an empirical discovery. People just studied galaxies until it became clear that that was true. But for people like me who are theoretical physicists trying to predict new things, that is these kind of green discoveries, life has been pretty tough since 1980. I went to grad school in the 80s, and so you can see that it's a very different situation now. And there's a lot of questions about why that is the case. And I don't think I want to delve too much into why that's the case, because, you know, if you're not discovering things, it's sort of hard to explain why you're not discovering things, right? You know, maybe I'm not smart enough, or maybe there's nothing to discover, I don't know. But anyway, the fundamental physics that was discovered in the 20th century completely transformed the world. For example, no one would have expected at the beginning of that century that we could turn sand into silicon chips that could compute, and we could make tiny little computers that we could fit in a cell phone, and that we'd all be walking around carrying high-powered computers made of basically silicon taken out of sand. Also, we learned how to make nuclear weapons that can destroy entire cities. We had this tragic situation that there was a race between the Germans and the Americans to create a nuclear weapon, and then the German effort failed pretty miserably, and when the Germans were beaten, the American team, by the way, which included many people from Germany who'd been kicked out of Germany, continued on to make the atomic bomb, and then it was used on Japan, completely devastating the city and completely changing the face of world history, so that now the threat of nuclear destruction is always sort of hanging like a sword of Damocles over us in any sort of conflict. As you can see with the Ukraine war, there's always this possibility hovering there, which so far, luckily, hasn't eventuated since the original two nuclear weapons in Hiroshima and Nagasaki. So there were massive effects, in short, on the whole world from the discoveries of fundamental physics in the 20th century. And let me not try to get into too much of what these discoveries were, but let me just give you like a quick tour of how we shrunk inwards, looking at ever smaller things and figuring out how they worked. So first we figured out how atoms work. This is actually a photograph of an individual hydrogen atom. A hydrogen atom is the simplest kind of atom. It has a proton, a single proton as its nucleus, and a single electron going around it. The marvel of quantum mechanics is that that electron doesn't really have a definite location. It's just a cloud of probabilities. But if you look to see where it is, you may or may not see it there. And so if you look over and over again to see where the electron is, you'll get different answers. And if you keep track of those answers and you draw little dots each time you see it here, 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 you'll get a picture of a cloud. And so this cloud is that a picture of that for a specific hydrogen atom in a particular energy level that produces this kind of nice sort of double wave pattern. So this is a real thing here. Atoms are about a million times smaller than the width of a human hair, if you want to get some sense for how much you have to zoom in before you can see individual atoms with the help of equipment. But then, of course, the question became, well, what's in that nucleus, or what's in the electron? But it turns out the nuclei are more, you can make more progress understanding them, because although the hydrogen just has a single proton in its nucleus, other atoms have a bunch of protons and also particles called neutrons in their nucleus. So the nucleus is a more interesting blob of stuff. And so nuclear physics came about, and we figured out eventually how the nucleus works. This is not a photograph. This is like an artist's conception. I like it because it's more realistic than a lot of cartoon pictures you might see of a nucleus. So you see it's very blobby. It's a silicon nucleus. So now I'm in trouble. I think it has a bunch of protons and neutrons in it. I'm trying to remember the periodic table. I don't want to do that. I don't want to get caught on tape saying the wrong number of protons and neutrons. It doesn't matter. I didn't have to say it was silicon. I could have said it was carbon, and he would have believed me, right? But because all particles are waves, they're not just like a little blob sitting there, like little billiard balls or something. There's just a wave function of probability of finding them in different places. And so that's what you're seeing here. And so this is about 10,000 times smaller than the hydrogen atom that I showed you before. And the math required to describe how this works is much more complicated than the math that that Schrodinger came up with that describes the hydrogen atom. So it took a lot of work throughout the century to reach the point of understanding nuclei. And then we figured out how the individual protons and neutrons work. We figured out that each one of those is made of three particles called quarks, which are held together by particle/waves called gluons. And this picture is even farther from being an actual photograph. This is an artist's conception, and I'm a little bit less happy with this one than the previous one. I think someone should draw a better one, but I couldn't find a better one anywhere. So you sort of vaguely see there's a red, a green, and a blue thing there. That's because quarks have qualities associated to them that are metaphorically called color. That has nothing to do with color. It's just people ran out of names for things, and they say they're either red, green, or blue, but they don't really look red, green, or blue. And also, they don't look so big and fat and blobby, and they don't have like little lines connecting them like that. It's much more tricky to draw than even this, but this is pretty good. And quarks are much smaller than a nucleus, so we know for sure that they have to be at least 100,000 times smaller than a nucleus. So basically, for all we know, they are points. They're perfect mathematical points, in the sense that they're particles that are points, but their probability wave function of finding them is all smeared out. But we don't know for sure that they're points because there's nothing you can really do to be sure that something is infinitely small. So we just like keep trying harder and harder to see if there's any structure to these guys, these quarks, and we just haven't found anything yet. So all I can say is that they have to be at least that small, but they could be even smaller. And that's about where we are now. We don't know anything that quarks are made of, and we don't know anything that the electron is made of. And we have this beautiful theory called the Standard Model that describes how quarks and electrons and other particles like neutrinos interact with each other. And it seems to work awfully well. And people have been working very hard to try to find any deviation from the Standard Model. They have this enormous particle collider on the border of Switzerland and France trying to look for deviations from the Standard Model, and they haven't found any there. So that's sort of where it stands as far as the constituents of matter, although we also know that there are mysterious things going on. You may have heard of dark matter. No one knows really what it is or even if it is, but we know that galaxies are spinning in ways that they shouldn't if there is only the matter we saw. So there are mysteries, but they aren't mysteries that we have been able to make much progress on recently by doing experiments on Earth. So the Standard Model works very well. We can now actually do calculations to calculate the mass of the proton and the neutron and show why the neutron is a tiny bit heavier than the proton, 0.1% heavier approximately. To do that, they had to do a supercomputer calculation on this huge rack of computers here, which is sort of amazing that you need all this computational power just to simulate a single proton, right? So that's what I meant by saying that fundamental physics is about finding laws that could let you compute everything that you could possibly compute about the world in principle, right? So So when you try to do it in practice, you discover that even something tiny like a proton may be really straining your capabilities of computation. But it's still, I think, an amazing achievement that we can actually do something like that, because 50 years ago, we had no idea how to calculate the mass of a proton or a neutron. Now, there are still lots of things to puzzle about in fundamental physics, and I guess three of the most famous ones are these. So why are the galaxies all rotating around faster than they should, given the mass that we can see? So the heavier a galaxy is, the more matter there is in it, the more the force of gravity would tend to pull it in, which could only be counteracted by it spinning around. And galaxies are basically spinning around as if they had 10 times as much mass in them as all the mass that we've been able to see, like stars, gas, this and that, black holes, all sorts of things. So that's called dark matter. You can, in other words, you can solve the problem by making up some new invisible kind of matter that doesn't do anything except have this extra mass. And that actually works pretty well, that theory. I mean, there are lots of ways to test that theory is consistent, because there are lots of galaxies doing lots of different kind of things. So it's not just like a complete cop-out the way it might sound at first. But it's frustrating to physicists because they don't know what this dark matter is. And of course, there's the possibility that there isn't any dark matter and that there's something else that we're not understanding. So that's, I'd say, one of the key questions in fundamental physics. Another one I alluded to already is that you'd expect that due to particles attracting each other due to gravity, that the expansion of the universe would slow down, just like when you throw a ball up in the air, gravity pulls it back down. But in fact, the opposite is happening. It seems that the universe is expanding faster and faster. Now, Einstein, when he made up general relativity, he noticed there was a possibility in the theory called the cosmological constant. There's like an extra term you can stick in the equation that's like a perfectly consistent, reasonable term. And it's hard to do. It's hard to tweak general relativity. But if you put that in there, then it can have the effect of making the universe expand faster and faster. He actually put it in there for some other purpose, and then he eventually decided that I shouldn't have done that. but then it turns out that that's our best explanation of why the universe is expanding faster and faster, that there's this stuff which we call dark energy just permeating perfectly evenly throughout this room and the whole galaxy that makes the universe makes things want to push out faster and faster. But that's still not completely satisfying. You'd like to know why that works that way, and so that's a big puzzle. And finally, I've been talking a little bit about gravity. That's described as best we can by general relativity, which is Einstein's theory of gravity. And then all the other forces, the forces that hold the atoms together, that hold the nuclei together, that hold the protons and neutrons together, all those are described by the Standard Model. And all those forces, by the way, are described with the help of quantum mechanics. Whereas general relativity knows nothing about quantum mechanics. So what we have is this funny situation where we have two different great theories of the universe, one of which covers gravity and one of which covers everything else, but we haven't really unified those two theories. In other words, we don't even really know how to fit those two theories together in a consistent theory. It's just luckily for us that the inconsistencies between these two theories would only manifest themselves visibly in situations that are very extreme, like black holes or something, that we have not been able to study experimentally. So it's like we've got a jigsaw puzzle and we like know that it's not really fitting together yet, but we also can't find this place where it's not fitting together either. So that's a really big theoretical problem. That's not a problem like the first two. So the first two is we see something going on and we have no idea why it's going on and we're mystified. The third one is like we've got these two theories that are working great, but we don't know how to fit them together. So that third one tends to attract people who take more mathematical approach, because it's not about experimental data. It's about putting together theories. But we're stuck on all three of these despite huge amounts of work. And so people working on fundamental physics are very frustrated right now, and they're getting very grumpy, I'd say. I mean, the peak grumpiness was about 10 years ago, but there's a limit to how long you can stay angry at something, right? So maybe the, whatever, we're in the post-grumpy phase of fundamental physics, sort of the depression phase. And the other thing that sort of makes it a strange situation is that nobody that I know of thinks that further progress in these type of questions in fundamental physics is going to lead to any new technology, at least not anytime soon. I mean, maybe eventually, like, we'll be able to, like, make black holes and smash them into each other and do all sorts of sort of godlike things that move whole galaxies around. But we're just like nowhere near doing any of that kind of stuff. And so, unlike the 20th century, when new advances in quantum mechanics and so on would lead to new technologies like silicon chips and lasers and the kind of laser that this laser pointer here is, we don't see anything on the horizon like that for new advances in fundamental physics. So that adds another sort of downer note to people who wanted to work on fundamental physics. So it's taken me a while to come out and say this, but I'm going to say it. Today, the most exciting physics is not fundamental physics. So if any youngster wants to go into physics, I'll say, yeah, that's a great idea, but I don't think you should go into this so-called fundamental physics, which is a very specific kind of physics. I'm going to talk about other kinds of physics. So in particular, we have the standard model, we have general relativity. The standard model is already more than what we need to describe what's going on in the particles in this room here. But we have a long way to go in using that knowledge to do things. So it's like, if you know how to play all the scales and you know how to play all sorts of chords, that doesn't mean you're done with music, right? That's the opposite, in fact. It means like now you're ready to start playing some music. And so we can use our knowledge of fundamental physics to start doing interesting things, and that's what we're doing now. And we're gradually gaining what I'd call exquisite control over matter. So let me give you some examples of the kind of things that people are doing now. There are actually so many examples, I can't get anywhere near listing all of them, but I just want to list a few carefully chosen ones. So photons, okay, so photons are particles of light. And so as I said, thanks to quantum mechanics, every kind of particle is a wave, but also every kind of wave can act like a particle. Before Einstein came along, everyone thought that light was waves described by some equations called Maxwell's equations. But he said, yes, that's true, but also there's some other aspect, which is that they are also particles. The energy of waves comes in chunks. You can have one photon of red light and it will have a certain amount of energy, and you can have two photons of red light and it will have twice as much energy, but there's no way to have 1.5 photons of red light. So it comes in steps. And it's a very strange mixture of the continuous and the discrete. The waves are these wavy things, but they come in chunks too. It's hard to explain. But we know that it's true. We've done lots of experiments where you can measure photons going bing, 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 landing on a photographic plate, each individual photon making a little dot in the photographic plate. So those are photons. But the point is that this principle that every wave is a particle and vice versa doesn't just apply to light, it applies to all sorts of things. For example, sound. So if you have like a crystal, sound can go through the crystal. I'm just picking a crystal because in a crystal, the atoms are very regularly arrayed, like in a square array or hexagonal array or something. So that sound has a very simple description. It's just you've got these atoms lined up, but they can all sort of wiggle slightly from where they are. This picture is exaggerating quite a lot about how much they'd be wiggling. They wouldn't really normally wiggle that much. And as those wiggles move through the material, that's sound. But the interesting thing is quantum mechanics says that the energy in that sound comes in chunks. So actually sound, especially when you make it so precise, like in a crystal, comes in particles. And these particles are called phonons. Now, these are not fundamental particles. That is, they're not on the same status as electrons and quarks, but they are ways that something can wiggle, and therefore, by quantum mechanics, these wiggles come in individual chunks. And so sometimes they're called quasi-particles. But it's good to call them quasi-particles to emphasize they're like different than these fundamental particles. But in another sense, there's nothing quasi about them. You can do all sorts of things with them. You can collide them. You can, all the things you could normally do with particles, you can do with these. So that's very interesting. People can do interesting things with sound like that. But there are lots of other things. For example, if you have a crystal, each atom will have a bunch of electrons around it in the crystal. But sometimes you could like somehow knock one of those electrons off. So there'd be one atom that had an electron missing that would normally be there. And that missing electron, the absence of that electron, can move from atom to the atom. What's going on? What's going on is that like one atom says, hey, I have one less electron than I want to have. And it could like reach over and grab an electron from another atom. So what's really happened is that an electron is like moved over to this atom. But now this guy over here says, hey, now I don't have an extra electron. So another way to think about what happened is that the missing electron moved from here over to here. And this little 16 puzzle that you may have seen, where you're moving these little squares around with your finger, is a good example. You see that black thing there is the missing square, the thing that doesn't have a square. But as you push these squares around, that black thing will move around as if it were a thing. It's the absence of a thing, but it can move around as if it were a thing. And in crystals, that these holes really do act like particles. So in some crystals, the best way to think about electrical current is to think about electrons moving around. But in other kinds of crystals, the best way to think about what's going on when electrical current is flowing through them is actually holes moving around. In some sense, those are just two viewpoints on the same thing, but it turns out that sometimes you really want to think of the hole really acts so much like a particle that you should treat it like a particle. So transistors that we all use have, in fact, they're transistors of different kinds. Some transistors have extra electrons and some have holes, and so they're both very practical. But that's just the beginning of the fancier kind of things you can do. Because, okay, I said when you knock an electron off an atom in a crystal, then you have a missing electron, which is a hole. So that's an atom that is missing an electron. Well, electrons have a negative charge, so if you're missing an electron, then that hole actually acts like it has a positive charge. So an atom with a missing electron will be positive. So that's that blue thing in the middle there with that plus sign. That's a hole acting like it has a positive charge. But you may know that positive and negative charges attract each other. So if you have an electron around, which is that red thing, it will tend to orbit the hole because they attract each other. And they can orbit each other. And you notice that should remind you a little bit of an atom, because an atom is a positively charged proton with a negatively charged electron orbiting it. Well, this is just like that in the sense that you have a negatively charged thing orbiting a positively charged thing, except it's the positively charged thing is a more funny kind of thing, right? Because it's a missing electron. But the combination acts like a little mini atom, and it can move around. So it's a particle of some sort, and that particle is called an exciton, because what's really happened is if you had an electron that was sitting in that atom in the middle there, and you knocked it off, and now it's that red guy sort of waiting to fall back into the hole, but temporarily orbiting it. But it acts like a particle called an exciton. That is, the whole combined thing acts like a particle. So you can make materials that have excitons in them, and you can make a gas of excitons and so on. It's very exciting. Sorry, I couldn't resist that. So then after you spend 10 years doing experiments with excitons, you say, like, hey, well, we could do even weirder things. So like this. You could take that thin gray sheet in the middle there is some kind of crystal that is where you can easily create excitons. So you see there's like a hole and an electron there attracted to each other. the spiral rubber band there is just metaphorical, right? They're just attracting each other, and together they form an exciton. But what we're doing now is we're putting it between two mirrors. So the blue guys are mirrors. Light can bounce back and forth between the two mirrors, and the light always interacts with electrically charged things. So the light will push the electron around, and it will push the hole around, or pull on it. And so the light will interact with the exciton. But remember, light is made of particles too. So the light is photons. So what you get here is a situation where you have a bunch of photons bouncing it back and forth between the mirror, but they're interacting very strongly with these excitons. And it turns out that they can sort of blend with each other, that the photons can keep making the exciton excited, and the exciton can keep making the photon excited, and that the whole combination of them is a thing in itself, and that thing can move around, and that combined thing has a name too. It's another kind of particle. It's called a polariton. So people learned, hey, we can make more complicated particles, quasi-particles called polaritons. Remember, none of these are fundamental particles. These are just ways that things can wiggle that nonetheless act like particles in the sense that they can move around, they can have a mass, they can have energy, they can have all the things that other kind of particles can have. So, in fact, people have been doing amazing stuff with polaritons. So a polariton, you should really think of it as some kind of weird new particle that's a blend of matter, namely the exciton, and light, namely the photon. So in a lot of ways, they act like photons. They have no electric charge, but they're different because they move much slower than light. They actually have much more, they have mass, unlike photons, and they move much slower than light, and they can bump into each other and sort of slow each other down and stuff, so they can even form a liquid. So these are some photographs of a flow of polaritons around the little obstacle, which is that sort of black thing near the top here. And depending on how you set it up, you could make this fluid have no viscosity. It could be a superfluid, so it just flows right around the obstacle, or you could have it that it leaves a trail of ripples, like when a boat's going through an ocean, it leaves a wake, and it can do it in various ways. So basically, this is like as close as you can come to making liquid light. The idea is, could I make a liquid out of light? Well, no, because photons are massless and they're just zipping along at the speed of light. But if you slow them down by letting them interact with matter a bit, and form a sort of bigger blobby thing called a polariton, then you can do all this stuff, like make a liquid. So these are just a few of the many things that people are doing. This field is called condensed matter physics, meaning that you're studying liquids and solids, and you can craft liquids and solids to have all sorts of different behaviors, and you can make all sorts of kinds of liquids and all sorts of stuff. So there's lots going on, but you have to realize that physics doesn't happen in a vacuum, right? There's history going on, and the 21st century has a lot of big challenges. In particular, I want to focus on one. We've entered a new epoch. The Holocene was the geological epoch that we were in that we called the present. What a stupid name, right? I mean, it's always the present, right? But anyway. We were very self-centered back then, right? But now we're not in the present anymore. That was then. Now we're in the Anthropocene. It's defined to be the geological epoch when the biosphere is rapidly changing due to human activities. Human population shot up in large part due to mechanized agriculture, and all sorts of consequences are occurring. Of course, you hear about global warming a lot, and that's a real important thing. It's an incredibly huge challenge of this century. We've completely left the ice age cycles that had been going on actually for millions of years, although this just goes 400,000 years back. This is the concentration of carbon dioxide, which tracks pretty well with temperature, and we just went bing and shot up. And in fact, we're shooting up so fast that I can look at this graph and I can see that this graph is about 15 years old, because actually now we're like up about there. So we're in this situation where the Earth's climate is changing faster than it's changed as far as I know, maybe forever, although it's very hard to look back in fine-grained detail in geological records, but it's really amazing. And so the temperature of the Earth, which was low in the Ice Age, last Ice Age, reached a peak about 6,000 years ago, and then was beginning to cool down. We would have eventually had another big Ice Age, but then, bing, due to the increased carbon dioxide concentration, the temperature is shooting straight up in this geological time scale graph. So between high school for me and now, the amount of Arctic sea ice has gone down to one-third of what it was. So the whole Arctic is different now. That produces different weather patterns. As you know, big fires in Canada, just like last week. But I want to say that global warming is just the tip of the iceberg. If you thought that was fun, we're completely dominating the biosphere now. About one quarter of all the chemical energy that's sunlight captured by plants is now being used by humans. The amount of biomass of farmed mammals is about 14 times that of wild mammals. The amount of biomass of farmed birds is about 2.5 times that of wild birds. So wilderness is sort of a small thing now. The population of large ocean fish have declined 90% since 1950. The rate of species going extinct, which is very hard to estimate, is somewhere between 100 and 1,000 times the usual rate. We now take more nitrogen from the atmosphere and convert it into nitrates for the purpose of making fertilizer than all the natural processes that do that. And about 8 or 9 times as much phosphorus, a vital material for fertilizers, is flowing into oceans than the natural background rate because we sprinkle the fertilizer all over the place and just let it wash into the Mississippi and other rivers and contaminate the oceans and create dead zones. So everything is dramatically changing. So we really need new ideas to adapt to this world. We've been pretending that the Earth is essentially infinite and that we're just these little things whose effect is negligible and that we might as well just keep growing, making everything more and more happier and happier. But by acting that way, we reach the point where that's not true anymore. Now the Earth is not essentially infinite. Our effect on the biosphere is massive, and exponential growth of many kinds of things can no longer continue. So we have to really rethink our whole civilization, and we have to do it pretty fast, or we're running into various walls as we speak. So one thing we need to do is take some lessons from nature, and I don't really mean go back to nature, I mean learn from nature. So we have this simple picture that we often imagine that, like, the resources that we get somehow, mine them or something, we produce stuff, we make a product, and then we use the product. Well, that's very nice, except it's not really like that. Because really what's going on, right, is that there's waste going out when we produce, and there's waste going out after we consume. And by neglecting that, we're just like living in a fantasy world, which can't go on forever. But the interesting thing is that in nature, it doesn't work that way. There's not piles of waste sitting around like, oh, these animals have been like eating stuff and they just like dump their trash in the woods. Well, they do dump their trash in the woods in their own way, right? But that trash is just what something else needs to eat. So what's waste for us is resources in there, in the natural world. And we need to realize that's the sustainable way to have an ecosystem. So that seems like a good lesson. But it's actually very complex because the flows of matter and energy are very complex. There are many complex cycles. And now that we're in charge of the whole Earth, we need to understand those things and work with them instead of trying to fight against them. So global warming is just one of the things that we're going to have to learn how to deal with. So there are climate models, and those use a huge amount of physics. They're, in fact, the most complex scientific computations that humans have tried, and they involve a lot of fluid dynamics, all sorts of physics, also a lot of biology, a lot of other things. One of the main sources of inaccuracy of climate models is that we don't understand clouds very well, and clouds are, until recently, too small to fit into the grid that we use in these simplified models. So people don't know for sure whether like there are going to be more clouds or less clouds as it gets hotter. I mean, we're beginning to understand that, but it's incredibly important. And that's an aspect of physics that we need to understand. Luckily, nature has lots to teach us. For example, there are these minerals here called perovskites, which if you examine them at the atomic scale, have these beautiful atomic patterns, and they turn out to be really great for doing all sorts of interactions between electrons and photons. And so people are starting to make solar cells out of perovskites that are possibly competitive with the current silicon solar cells that also use ideas from quantum mechanics. But this is something that was found by examining what nature can do. Or another example, there are actually millions of examples, but I just like this one. So if you look at a butterfly, a lot of butterflies, not all, will have a luminescent kind of wings, sort of iridescent kind of wings. This is a particular species that does. And it turns out that that stuff is what's called a photonic crystal. It's a kind of crystalline pattern that is very small, but spaced about the wavelength of the light, and it makes for these colors. So there's not a blue dye on this, or blue-green dye on this butterfly. It's a crystal. And this particular one has a crystal that's in the shape of a pattern that's roughly this sort of shape here. This is a shape that was invented by a mathematician working for NASA called a gyroid. And, well, I shouldn't say it was invented by the mathematician because the butterfly might have different ideas about this. But the mathematician independently invented this shape and was wanting to use it as like a nice, very sturdy material for spacecraft, which didn't really get used that way. But we've discovered that the material in this butterfly wings is arranged in this same gyroid pattern. And so now we are beginning to understand that, and many other materials in nature are exquisitely patterned, and we are beginning to learn how to make them. But you'll notice the difference. If we just go ahead and try to make this kind of material, we'd like use a big lab with a bunch of chemicals and be like a whole bunch of waste, and we'd like have to be running up the electric bill trying to make this stuff. Whereas this butterfly, what does it do? How does it make it? It just flies around. It just flies around and eats nectar out of flowers, and then it somehow manufactures this material and it reproduces itself. So our technology is incredibly crude compared to the technologies of nature. And I think we have to catch up a little bit and learn physics and learn a lot from nature. And so I hope we do that in this century to come. Okay, thanks.
Okay, so if anyone has any questions, if you'll raise your hand, one of us will come with a microphone.
Yeah, just make up a question. Yeah, okay.
Thank you. Is there a point at which we can find that the problem between gravity and quantum mechanics exists? Like, do we know like where that area is to search?
So far, finding that problem seems very far away from anything we're capable of doing. So for example, we've been making particle accelerators to smack particles into each other more and more energetically to basically examine particles on smaller and smaller distance scales to see what's going on tinier and tinier. And that's what's gotten us down to the point of saying that like a quark has to be at least 100,000 times smaller than a nucleus. But to get to we believe that if you kept on going smaller and smaller, that gravity effects would actually matter. But those effects happen at much, much smaller scales. I'm sorry I don't remember the figure now, but so I'll be very conservative and say, I'm sorry, I should know these numbers, but I haven't thought about them lately. But it's... say at least trillions times smaller than that is when you might see gravity effects. So we can't build particle accelerators that can do that. And I don't think we'll ever be able to do that unless we like come up with some amazingly different technology. We could like try to make very small black holes, but if you ever tried to do that, you know, it's like really hard. It's sort of easy to make enormous black holes. You just get like a huge gas cloud, like a galaxy-sized gas cloud, and let it collapse under its own gravity, and it forms a black hole for you. But to make a small black hole turns out to be much harder, and you need it to be small for the quantum effects to matter enough for us to have a chance to see. So basically, I think that we're sort of stuck experimentally in quantum gravity, as far as I know. I mean, I don't want to be like Lord Kelvin, okay? So I'm going to stick on the tape here. Like, maybe someone will have a bright idea and they'll like figure out how to do it. But right now we have no clue.
Hi, thank you so much for that lecture. It was really lovely. But on the end slide, when you were talking about that crystal that causes the butterfly's wing to be green, and you were talking about how it would be very complicated for us to create that same crystal.
We can do it.
Yeah, but
we can already do that kind of thing, by the way. But it's complicated, yeah.
But it's far easier and far less waste-producing for the butterfly to do.
Yes.
What uses, like, obviously you've talked about spacecraft, but what uses could we make of these kinds of things that we don't have really the use to have our backs become green or whatever? So I'm just wondering, like, what uses we could make of that.
It's hard for me to know exactly what are the best uses of that thing. I think if we were able to make materials that could easily change color a TV screen is such a thing, right? It's a material that changes color, okay? But it's using power to shoot out the light. But if you could make material that just would passively change color, I'm sure people would think of cool things to do with it. I'm sorry that I don't really instantly know. Yeah, it's like some amazing thing that we could do with that. The ability to get matter to interact with light in novel ways is also what's going on with solar cells. So there, at least, you can see, like, okay, we want to get materials that can absorb, for example, making materials that could absorb lots and lots of different frequencies of light so that it would really soak up all the sunlight and turn it into electricity would be a great thing. There are limits on how efficient a solar cell can be if there's basically one frequency that it's good at absorbing. So people are starting to make multi-band solar cells that could go further. One interesting thing about that, by the way, is that people sometimes ask, why are plants green? Because if a plant wanted to soak up as much energy as possible from the sun, it would be black. So why aren't plants black? And the answer is, plants don't need all that energy. They don't want to be black. If they were black, in fact, they'd get too hot. So they're not trying to absorb as much energy as possible. So that's why they pick some color or other. That doesn't answer why they're green, but it's why they don't bother to be black. There are lots of scientific papers about why plants are green, by the way. We don't know. I mean, chlorophyll is green, makes it look green, okay, but why chlorophyll? Sorry.
Since we're on the butterfly, I thought I'd just plus that and ask another question, and keeping in mind that my knowledge of physics is limited to what I've seen on the Big Bang Theory. when you talk about learning from nature, do you mean something like learn how the butterfly manufactures so that we could make our manufacturing so much more close to that and avoid waste? Are you talking about like, let's have a bunch of butterfly farms and harvest the crystals? Or is something entirely different?
Yeah, no, I'm not trying to like harvest lots of butterflies and kill lots of butterflies. That would be, I think that Our whole economy now is based on technology that has seemingly inevitable waste as part of it, right? So for example, like with car batteries, if you're trying to go electric, you say, okay, great, we're going to make car batteries. But the car batteries are made out of materials like nickel and so on. And eventually, they either get thrown out if we don't know how to recycle them, or even in the manufacturing process, there are these toxic chemicals that are put out. We just don't know how to make stuff without also making a bunch of horrible side effects. So people complain about nuclear power, but you have to compare that to, for example, fossil fuel power, where the idea is, what do you do with all the poisonous byproducts? I know, I'll just shoot it up into the air, right? So there's vast numbers of deaths due to fossil fuel power, millions of deaths per year to do that. And so I think it's possible for us to get a civilization that doesn't work that way, that doesn't have all that waste. And the reason why I think that is that if you look at nature and how ecosystems work, they don't work that way. They work a different kind of way. And so I think that we can learn a lot of lessons from that. I'm not saying that we like go back to nature and go back to primitive farming, but I'm saying like learn how to be as smart as how nature got by sheer Darwinian evolution through billions of years. Yes?
Oh. Jess, do you have a question?
She's the moderator. I can't see everyone.
Actually, John, I have a quick question. Thank you for a nice talk.
Yeah.
So you talked a lot about the sort of energy side of physics tonight, but you, of course, also work in information theory and on the relationship of entropies to each other. And I'm just wondering if you have a comment on maybe how the 21st century would deal with the relationship between energy and information, or a sort of comment on the future of physics with respect to information.
Yeah, so there's a lot to say about that. I'm very interested in information theory, but in sort of the more practical side of things, what I think is interesting is that one way we potentially could lighten our impact on the biosphere is by moving from what you might call an energy-based economy to an information-based economy. So where, for example, instead of like going from someplace to someplace else by hopping on a large conveyance that shoots through the sky, shooting out lots of fossil fuel residues and lands you there, you communicate by Zoom or something like that. So that's a step forward. But you have to realize that even that information economy that we're working towards is still very energy intensive. It's extremely energy intensive. So I think we have to keep trying to sort of virtualize our civilization, making it more aiming towards information and less brute energy. But then I think we also have to start thinking about what is all this information for, because sheer wads of bits is not really what we're after either. Sort of one step up after information is something that's harder to put a finger on, that's something like meaning or knowledge. And so if we could someday move towards a knowledge economy, or maybe that knowledge sounds like you know a bunch of facts, but I don't really just mean that, so maybe a meaning economy, that would be great. But we really don't, I think, have very good knowledge even of how to quantify that, right? So we learned how to quantify energy, and then we can build steam engines and know how much energy you can get out of a steam engine due to the laws of thermodynamics. Then Shannon realized that the information is also part of the story, and we now know how to quantify information. But we don't really know at all how to quantify meaning, so we don't really know how to like optimize things in terms of meaning. And then I think there's probably something even after meaning, which I call wisdom, which is like the right meaning. that's like, we don't know anything about that. So I think that those are directions we should try to go in. So I guess you could say that information theory is like trying towards understanding concepts like meaning right now.
Thank you. John, I have one over here.
Oh, hello? Hi.
Hi, sorry, I can't tell where you are.
I'm over here.
Just keep talking and I'll eventually echo Kate. Oh, there.
Hi, John. Really cool talk.
Thanks.
Just not really a question, more just a comment. That crystal, the photonic crystal, enabled the frequency comb, which allows us to count light, which may one day allow us to sense the gravitational fields caused by dark matter, or at least these are ideas, so it's happening right now.
Okay, I'll have to talk to you about that. Here's a question. Oh, well, I guess there's another question, sorry. I'm not in charge of picking the question. Yeah.
Thank you very much. I'm Helen Muller. And one comment and one question that the comment is that you didn't mention anything about DNA and how genetics and physics has been fused in terms of developing DNA, the analysis. My question is, you mentioned that the universe is expanding, and I'm just wondering if you could expand on that and tell us a little bit about what the implication is for the human being.
Okay.
If the universe is expanding.
Yeah. So, I mean, I don't, there's a lot to say about that. I mean, I'll just whiz through some basic things. So, I mean, the Hubble was the first one to discover that there are other galaxies than our own. And then later on, he noticed that the more distant ones were redshifted. The light was stretched out in a way that would be explained by them moving away from us. And the further away they are, the faster they seem to be moving away from us. Then we realized that that's what you'd expect from Einstein's theory of gravity, that you couldn't just have galaxies just sitting there at rest with respect to each other, because gravity would pull them into each other and there'd be a big crunch. They would all collapse. So the only alternative is to have them basically be moving away from each other. If you look at what happens in the past, that means that there would have to be one moment in time when they all basically met, that would be the Big Bang. And now we have a lot of detailed information about the very early history of the universe and close to the Big Bang. We have no idea what happened at the Big Bang, or whether there was a before the Big Bang. That's where things get very murky, and we would probably want a theory of quantum gravity to help us out. If you think about the far future of the universe, there's an interesting thing that's due to the fact that the universe is not only expanding, but the expansion is accelerating. And that fact is this. It's not at all obvious, but it's a thing you can calculate, that if we wait too long, the galaxies that we could ever in principle get to become fewer and fewer. That is, galaxies that are very far away from us, that we can just barely see, are moving very far, very fast from us, very fast away from us, but because the expansion is accelerating, it turns out you can show that there'd be no way in principle to send a space probe to catch up with them. Even if it was going almost at the speed of light, it couldn't catch them. And so the realm of the universe that we will have ultimate access to, assuming that we live forever or that some other better civilization lives forever, will keep shrinking and shrinking. And eventually, in fact, the only things that hang together are things like galaxies and small groups of galaxies. But then if you wait long enough, even those slowly fizzle apart because of randomly various stars will pick up enough energy by just chance to shoot off of a galaxy. So basically, we think that everything is going to just sort of dissipate and fall apart until eventually every single fundamental particle, like a proton or electron, will just be completely isolated from everything else. So my lesson from that is I should get my act together and get going and do stuff now. And maybe as a civilization we should. But the good news is that's like on a billion year time scale that we have to worry about that. So I'm mainly worried about like whether we'll get through the next 100 years or so.
Well, that's my question. Are you optimistic about the future of humanity? Do you see any way that technology can close the gap between ever-increasing human consumption on a finite planet?
I don't think more of the same approach to technology can do it, because our approach to technology, the more we intensify the use of the kind of technology we know how to deal with now, the more we impose on the biosphere, the more damage and degradation we cause to the biosphere. So I think the only way out is not just like more technology of the kind that we're used to making, but basically new social systems and a new attitude towards what technology is supposed to be doing. And so I don't really want to say if I'm optimistic about it or not, but I think it will require some kind of crisis to get us out of our business as usual mentality. I mean, you know, the United Nations is putting out alerts saying like, look, we're in serious trouble here with global warming. We've got like 10 years to stop carbon emissions if you want to stay below 1.5 degrees warming. And we don't think we're going to do that. So basically, we're just going to get into more and more trouble until we shape up. And so I don't know if that counts as optimistic or not, right? But it's like nature is giving us stronger and stronger nudges to like get our act together.
Thank you, John, for the wonderful talk. I have a question for you. As far as I know, most fundamental physicists are not interested in condensed matter physics or fluid dynamics. How would you usher any of that energy, the intelligence and the intellect, into actual, this is more applied, right?
Sorry, how would I get like fundamental physicists interested in
Think about these questions of not creating waste, because they are definitely not driven by the questions of are we creating waste or are we not creating waste? They're driven by a whole different set of questions. How would you even, because colliders, yes, they create a lot of waste and they're building a giant one, you know?
Yeah, well,
mm-hmm. How would you even bring this question up or ask?
Well, one way I do it is I give a talk that's sort of like this, but sort of more hard-edged to actual physicists, audiences of physicists, where I try to tell them, like, fundamental physics is just not going anywhere. It hasn't gone anywhere since 1980. You should get out. And mainly I aim that not at, like, people who are already doing it, but the more impressionable grad students, I could say, like, look, do you want to do something really cool that's like going to have a big effect, or do you just want to keep on trying to do what we've been trying to do since 1980 and not succeeding? So I think, so basically, well, you know, Max Planck said, science advances one funeral at a time, right? A very snide but true remark. So that instead of like trying to persuade oldsters to change their ways, it's probably more productive to try to get youngsters to see what's exciting. And so I also like try to convince science magazines and so on that they should start having more articles about condensed matter physics and try to make that seem cool instead of things like black holes and string theory and so on, which are really not going to impact us that much. I think it's not just due to me, but that's starting to happen. Yeah, I mean, a whole bunch of people went into physics in my generation because they saw Einstein as this amazing figure, and they said, hey, that looks like a great thing to do. I'll do that. Yeah, right, yeah. what's really getting somewhere now, what's really making progress is other branches of physics than the idea of like, oh, I'll be the next Einstein. I'll unify the standard model in quantum mechanics. So I think eventually it's bound to catch on. I'm just trying to speed it up a little.
I think we have time for one or two more questions. Melissa's headed to a hand.
Given the state we're in now, Homo sapiens, it's hard for me to imagine that some of these problems we think about and concepts is within our capability, that the ultimate answers are going to come from AGI, artificial general intelligence. How close are we to assigning these problems and these solutions to machines rather than ourselves?
Things are changing very rapidly with AI, so that's a great area for me to not make any predictions in. I will say that, like, right now, AI is really crappy at doing physics. But, you know, that could be quite different 10 years from now. I don't personally think that just large language models will be the be-all and end-all of AI, because I don't know if any amount of scraping the internet will let you make a revolutionary discovery in physics. I mean, there are a lot of crackpots out there, and you can unify all their theories and come up with a better one. But no, that's not how to do it. But advances in AI are happening so fast that, yeah, that could render a whole bunch of our current expectations of the future way outdated in 10 or 20 years. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's right. So there, you know, humans may not be the big thing anymore.
Thank you. What you're saying is making me think about AI as one direction to go in, but how actively do physicists seek out collaboration with metaphysicists and visionaries? And do you think that has any, the translation of some of their thinking would have an impact on your thinking?
Yeah, that's an interesting question. I think when you start trying to combine sort of mystical or visionary thinking with science, it's very easy to screw up. It's so easy to blunder in different ways that most physicists sort of just would rather you not try to do that. But it is also true that a lot of the best physicists in the 20th century did have a strong mystical or visionary streak to them, like Einstein and Pauli and so on. And so, yeah, I don't know. The mystical side of things is something that doesn't seem to get conveyed very well through speech or conversation. So, you know, as soon as you start talking about that stuff, you start to sort of contaminate it and mess it up. So unless you're like really careful at writing, which some poets are able to do. So I'm certainly not really able to say much about that. But so I think there's a realm out there that's interesting, but 99% of what's said about it is just complete baloney. So I'm not going to try to add to that.
Hello. Thank you for the great talk over here. Okay. I just really latched on to what you said about moving towards an economy of meaning. And I wonder if you could say a little bit more about that, because I think that might also be something that bridges that other world of metaphysics where people are trying to find that meaning, and you seem to think that it is meaningful to find that meaning, but what do you mean by that?
That's quite a question you planned out there. Yeah, yeah. Okay, it just came right out. That's nice, that's great. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, the interesting thing is that we have these economic indicators of economic growth like GDP, and we sort of seem to have all, to some extent, fooled ourselves into thinking that, like, increasing those indicators are the ways to become happier. But we know that that's not really true. And now, luckily, there are economists thinking about happiness to realize that it's not, getting happier is not the same thing as, like, economic growth or more use of resources. Of course, if you're starving, there's certain things you need to be happy, but if you're past a certain point, the increase in happiness and especially the increase of what I'd call meaningful happiness, comes through very different things that could be extremely cheap in terms of like the normal economy of dollars, right? I mean, like the right sort of book could you know, cost a few bucks and provide a lot more deep, meaningful happiness than any number of plane trips around the world to seeing all sorts of cool sights. And so I think we're gonna be pressured by nature into realizing that. I mean, everyone sort of realizes it, but somehow we forget it, right? And so we say, I don't want to read a book. I'd rather go on a flight, you know. So, but when it starts becoming like illegal to emit more than a certain amount of carbon because, you know, the governments have cracked down on it because they realize that it's a problem or whatever, when we all realize that it's just too deleterious to the environment, then maybe that book will start looking better. And so basically, the sooner we start realizing that, the better it's all going to be for everybody.
Uh-huh. Thank you all for coming. If we could have one last round of applause for John Baez.
Thanks.